It's been a while since I've worked with pencil, which seems like such a funny thing to say. But most of my work for the last couple months has been based on pen, or digital, or watercolor, or gouache. All these things that have, I don't know, a little bit more inbuilt grace. I feel like most of our art in some capacity starts with pencil. A lot of the work that we do in high school, a lot of the work that we do in college, if you go to art school, is pencil. There's something fundamental about it. I sometimes wonder if I turn my back on it because it feels like it's elementary, because it feels like it's part of my past. Maybe I'm trying to escape from pieces of my past. Or maybe it just feels so fundamental that it's not as exciting, and I have a tendency to run to the new and exciting thing. But I think that there's some things that you can do with pencil that you just can't do with other things. And though I lament that it smudges, and that I usually get excited about what I'm doing in the interim and forget to do simple things like get a paper towel so my hand doesn't smudge what I'm working on, or I don't remember that my hands will slowly pick up all of the pigment and begin to smudge it everywhere. There are some really valuable things about pencil, and it feels like returning to its roots, to my roots, to our roots. I think sometimes it's this weird wimpy part of me that doesn't like to get dirty. You know, you don't get as dirty when you work with pen. You do, you know, occasionally, but in general, it doesn't smear. It doesn't smudge. It's just a different medium, and I really like that aspect of it. And it's still tangible, because I get a little bit weird about working with digital media, because it doesn't feel tangible. The paper's resisting me right now. You know, this pencil is not ridiculously sharp, and so as I'm working with it, I can feel the resistance of the page. And that helps me know how hard to press. It helps me to unconsciously know how far a mark has gone. There are a lot of wonderful, valuable things about working in pencil. Just because it's common, just because it's what we put a lot of our time into when we were young, perhaps, doesn't make it less miraculous, doesn't make it less valuable. It's still this bizarre, wonderful thing. It makes so much more noise. A thing I wouldn't really be conscious of if I was listening to music right now, or if I was just absorbed in my own world. But as I record this, as I speak, I'm conscious of the noise. And you can see the texture that is appearing, this random, you know, tooth of the paper is showing through, and it's creating these marks that I did not anticipate. And that's actually a huge portion of what I run into with moving to digital art, is there's so much less randomness. It feels like every mark that I put down has to be intentional, and it's representative. And sometimes when you're working with watercolor, oil, acrylic, or even pencil, like right now, certain things happen that you didn't anticipate. You know, I didn't plan on having this texture of the paper show through there. If I was working digitally, that wouldn't have happened. That would have just been smooth. But now there's a little bit of implied texture that I didn't have to make myself. It's just the medium made it for me. And that happens on canvas because the canvas has texture, and it happens as you paint over marks that you've already painted because they start to accumulate and you get brush strokes. And sometimes it's intentional and sometimes it's not. For me, often it's not. I don't feel like I'm good enough yet to have a full understanding of how all my marks are going to come out in the end. And maybe that's my ignorance, assuming that, you know, you do get to a point where that is something you do. Maybe you don't. But I know some pretty good painters, and I think that they would probably have a better concept of that and how that functions. And that you can have an understanding of, if I pull the brush this way, it's going to do this thing. And I get bits and pieces of that the more I work with a medium. And I think that's just the reality of it, is the more time you spend in a medium, the more you come to understand it and anticipate it and anticipate all of its quirks. And man, are there a lot of quirks. I have this tendency to get ahead of myself, and I'm over here because I want to see where things are going to go and how things are going to pan out. But now that mark is going to be something that's going to be very easy for me to smudge. I have a feeling smudging is just going to be a part of this. I'm not sure I'm going to keep myself from smudging. I think it's just going to be a matter of trying to control it. These are charcoal pencils, by the way. I ordered them a little while back. They're pretty soft. I ordered white and black, and this is the first time that I'm working with them. So I haven't practiced or put time into figuring out what they're gonna do and how they're gonna operate. It's been a while since I've used any form of charcoal. I definitely like this form more because it's less dirty, and I'm kind of a wimp when it comes to getting dirty. I don't have much in the way of OCD tendencies, and wouldn't claim to, as I know for a lot of people it's an actual issue, and for me it's just some of my proclivities. But I really don't like my hands being dirty when I'm trying to do precision things. If I'm out like working in the yard or on a car or something, I kind of just have this understanding that like dirtiness is going to happen, and I don't mind it. But when I'm working on precision things, or if I get grease on my hands while I'm driving, or while I'm typing on a computer, like I just, really struggle. Can't do very well with that. One of the things that I'm noticing immediately in my transition from pencil back, or from pen back to pencil, is goodness how nice and gradual you can make shading. It's so nice in comparison. You can do it with pen, especially ballpoint that I've been using lately, but it is not as natural and it's not as easy. Like, this is coming along pretty naturally. Does not take much for this white to get dirty. The white seems to scratch a lot more. You get interesting things too with the sharpness kind of going back and forth. And as I work with these, they dull and you get slightly different marks. And I've spent most of my time drawing with mechanical pencils because they're a little bit more consistent and a little bit more reliable. But one of the cool things that you get out of traditional pencils is they change and they warp over time. And that means, again, you get some things that you did not anticipate. Which the older I get, the more I enjoy, the more I appreciate the unanticipated things. Let's see what happens if I do this. Kind of merge it together to make kind of a gray. I'm not sure if I like that, but we're kind of committed now. I think to continue that, I would have to bring in this black and then lightly go over it again with the gray. I wonder how easy it's going to be to get that to continue. Let's see. Not terrible. Now the pencil's gonna be all dirty. Need a backup piece of paper to work with that. But yeah, that's fine. I often wonder about how I jump between mediums so much, and if that's a good idea or not. I think that probably the mediums are not particularly important, but the thing that I'm representing probably is more important. So if I'm shifting subject matters all the time and not giving myself enough time in any particular one to learn the lessons that I need to, that's probably detrimental. But the actual shifting between the medium probably isn't, I don't think. What do you guys think? Is it better for artistic progress to just do one thing? To play with one medium? Or should you be jumping back and forth? Should you definitely not be jumping back and forth? Does it not matter? When I was in the classroom, obviously, we did lots of different media in the drawing classes. Painting class, we kind of tended to start with watercolor usually because it's this the simplest to get started in. It's easy to clean up. It dries relatively quickly. Then usually we went on to either tempera or acrylic. And then in the upper division classes, we would eventually have the option for students to work with oils. And oils are fantastic, but they are very messy. Or at least they have the potential to be. And a lot of times the old school oils are toxic. And I know they make non-toxic ones now. I don't know that I've ever actually used them. I think I've only ever used the old school varieties. Unless, you know, that's not correct, but I'm almost positive that all of my paints are old school oil paints. And so they were kind of daunting, and that's where we would end, you know, as much as you end anything artistically, that's where we would kind of end the exposure to media, is oil paints. Now, I love them because the quality of the color is so intense. And for me, that was always a huge driving factor in why oil paints were worth using. I've had a lot of friends, though, that have stuck with acrylic instead. And one of the biggest reasons is just that oils dry so slowly. And so people that like to work iteratively find it a little harder to work with oil paint. And so acrylic makes that a little bit more doable. But either way, I guess the point there is that in painting classes, we tended to go through with the probably incorrect notion that oil paint is the highest form of painting. And so that was the goal, was to get the kids to where they could oil paint or at least have the ability to do that. Over time, I started to shift that to be, you know, we're going to expose you to each of these. And then as you grow up and grow with your medium, you can start figuring out what you like to do and what makes the most sense for you. And at, you know, by the time I ended teaching in the classroom, I had a pretty good understanding of what would hit most kids correctly, what they ought to spend their time doing, or at least, not that I got to determine what they did, but that I would have a knack for figuring out what would fit them best. And so I could help them kind of on their journey of discovery a little bit more efficiently, which I think really largely is the goal of an art teacher. It's not, you know, you need to expose kids to things and you need to teach them things, but a lot of it is, once you get past the fundamentals, is mostly just providing an environment that allows them to be exposed to the media and the techniques that are going to align with their soul and allow them to do what they need to do. Because if they're taking a lot of art classes and they're creative and they're seeking to hone those skills and learn how to be more creative, then, you know, they've got to find their medium. They've got to find the thing that works best for them. And, you know, that's, I think, really part of the job and goal of an art teacher, is to help your students find, not, I don't know, I hate to say find their voice, because I think that's a pretty trite saying, but it might actually be accurate in this sense. But in drawing classes, we often shifted the media all the time. Like, it would not be odd to have, you know, project after project after project, you know, we shift. And so there's almost no consistency. You know, this project's in colored pencil, this project's in pastel, this project's in ink, this project's in regular pencil, this project's back to watercolor now. And that shifting exposed the kids to a lot of things. And I think that part was beneficial, but I'm not sure. And I went back and forth about this, and I'm not sure that I ever came to a good conclusion. But what is the goal? What's the purpose of a high school art class? It's kind of how I process almost everything in the universe, is I just try to look at each thing and go like, what is the purpose of this? What is the purpose of school in general? What is the purpose of a history class? What is the purpose of an art class? And I kind of came to the conclusion that there's probably two separate goals for art classes, that you have the kids who, you know, barring the odd situation of the kid who's just looking for a credit or looking for a class that's going to be easy. But you've got kids who are looking for the art class because it's fun. And you've got kids who are looking for the art class because they want to grow and they want to get better at making art. And that's oversimplifying it for sure. But, you know, you can't always deal with all of the crazy minutiae of the world. Sometimes you have to simplify things. And that kind of felt like what it was for most students, that either they were in there because they wanted to be a better artist, or they were in there to learn some things and have fun. So if you have those two, not entirely diametrically opposed, but those two very different kinds of students in your class, how do you work with that? How do you construct an environment that is beneficial to both? And that was one of the big struggles for me planning every year. I had a tendency to redo my curriculum every single year. And that was one of the reasons, was I was always trying to get to this platonic ideal of how do you construct an art class that is hitting as many different students in the best way possible. And it was hard, and I don't think I ever came up with a perfect solution, but I do think that every year I did a little better. And I was also just so flabbergasted by how many teachers would just teach things the way they always taught things. That was very, very common for teachers to just, you know, they build their curriculum over the course of 2 or 3 years and then be like, okay, cool, like, I'm done. And every time I talk to somebody like that, I was like, but, like, aren't you bored? Like, isn't there, like, potentially a more efficient way to do this? And it just seemed like a bewildering question to them, in the same way that I was flabbergasted by somebody stopping their progress and just assuming that, you know, this is good enough and I'll stick with it. I, you know, they were just as flabbergasted that I would have that question, you know. But for me, I couldn't settle. I couldn't sit there and go, you know, yeah, this will work, you know, this takes care of it. Because I'd sit there and I'd look and go, okay, like, these 6 students here, you know, they're just here to have a good time. And I don't really feel like that's wrong. Like, art can be a lot of different things to a lot of people. And I definitely had to fight the urge to be a little upset at them because, you know, it felt like they weren't taking art seriously. But that's, again, art is a serious thing and it should be taken seriously, but that doesn't mean that it needs to be taken seriously by everyone. There's nothing wrong with people who treat art as a craft, who go online and, you know, find little videos on how to make crafts for Christmas or for people's birthdays or whatnot. There's nothing wrong with that. It's not quite the same beast as making a beautiful oil painting or exploring your depression or your emotions through art, but it doesn't make it less valid. It might make it, like, slightly less sophisticated, but again, you know, that would be like looking at literature and being like, any literature other than Moby Dick, you know, level sophistication is just pointless and shouldn't exist. It's like, no, like, there's a place for the Hunger Games, there's a place for Harry Potter. Like, they may not be quite as literarily sophisticated, but, you know, you can't have filet mignon and, you know, couscous and caviar every meal. Like, you've got to have just, like, your normal stuff. You've got to have your nostalgic meals. Like, there's always a place for peanut butter and jelly. But it's tough to design a class that functions well for the casual kid and also for the kid who wants to take it seriously. And I think an ideal structure would be to have, like, intro art courses / art appreciation courses where, you know, this is built for you just to come in and have fun. Like, the express goal is for you to learn about art and have fun. And I think that something like that might be really beneficial, because then you could have more of the serious art classes. And so you could have the kids who just want to make things and have some fun. They take art appreciation 1, 2, and 3. And then you have the kids who are like, nah, like, I want to take painting. I want to take sculpture. I want to take ceramics. And that delineation would give the teacher the ability to push much, much more consistently. And that was the problem I ran into. I had the desire, you know, from my own ego, I had the desire to make the class as serious as I could and make it into something that would produce fantastic artists. And in my younger years, I think I did that. And in the school that I taught, that was kind of the expectation for how most teachers were working. But again, over time, as I got older, as I got more mature, I realized, like, no, that's not right, especially not for art. You know, there's nothing wrong with somebody who wants to come in and just have fun and draw. But I always tried to build structures that would allow me to take care of both kinds of students. And as the years progressed and the school progressed and I got more advanced level classes and started being able to teach, like, AP studio art, I started to get into, like, okay, like, if you're in this class, like, the assumption is that you're taking it seriously and you want to grow. And I had a lot of fun with that because that meant that I could really help the kids, you know, push and define their art styles and define, you know, what they wanted to do with art and allow them to have a much stronger voice. And the environment is better, I think, in a lot of ways when you have that consistency. I think there are some things to be said for sure by having, you know, casual people and really, really strict and intense people in the same realm. But there's also a wonderful thing to be said for, you know, everyone who's here is serious about this. That's a really, really nice thing. I think sometimes you end up challenging yourself a little bit more when you feel like everyone around you is taking it really seriously.